More examples? Anyone? Court, yes.
Which is about a group of women who traveled to the South Pole. And are there such things as spoilers? Like, should
now?
Well, I guess that's the part that counts. It's a group of women who traveled to the South Pole.
So, just for no reason, like I said, does Andre Norton have anything to throw the bunny trap line?
Because she's really, really smart.
Anybody?
Yeah.
All right. Interesting.
No,
it's okay. Maybe you need to write like the Andre Norton tribute.
I have a really alien hat.
And I guess there's also all the opposites that we can think of. I was thinking about that this was kind of the anti-survivor, because I don't think they're ever going to get around to doing survivor. Antarctica or something, because part of the point of Survivor is to get people out there in their in their underwear. is that part of it, do you think? Like, does the fact that it's an icy track mean that you're removing that sort of body as object of desire from the equation?
I do think that maybe that has, that's one of the reasons why it seems like we can get down to pondering these feminist questions of characters who are on these sorts of journeys. It does sort of eliminate that layer that has to be sort of gotten through before you can actually field the issues at hand. So I think that makes a lot of sense. And I think there must be some sort of element of looking at nature as a sort of feminine construct in and of itself, and I think that maybe one of the reasons that that we see these stories with women having these experiences on Tundra is because we have a whole sort of Mother Nature mythos that we're drawing from, and it's sort of, it's women encountering this sort of somehow female obstacle out in the world. And
that's basically the plot of my novel. Just spoiled it all. The girls who journey across it together as fighting this time eventually as lovers then have to encounter her directly. It's kind of funny.
I think there's also an element of just reflecting reality going on, because as somebody who's done field work both in really comfortable conditions in the tropics and in conditions where we were cold and felt like we were dying the whole time, the adverse cold conditions really do promote group bonding way more than the comfortable in the tropics conditions.
That was one of the things I was wondering about when I read the blurb for the panel. Unless someone can come up with an example of the frozen female bunny track earlier than Le Guin, one of the things I was wondering is if a lot of this is just her very strong imprint, and the other is there something about the cold climate specifically, as opposed to like female desert tracks like Mad Max.
Right.
You know. So how do you say that the physical isolation and hardship of the climate does bind people makes a lot more sense than for isolating your characters and putting them in a situation where if there are any number of landscapes where you could drop two or three people and need them to work together to survive. Like, you can do that in the middle of the forest, you can do that in the middle of the desert, you can do that at sea. You know, so what is it about cold climates if it's not just, you know, the long-lasting echo of the wind?
Well, you have to cuddle. So, that's key element. So, do you want to talk more about the, what is it that does people together?
I'm not actually sure. I can think of circumstances where there was a lot of gathering around the fire in all sorts of different climates. So it's not just that you're physically being put closer together because you have to huddle. But I think there's something about being cold that's very, it makes you very viscerally aware of the necessity of survival.
I feel like in those tundra landscapes too, there's also sort of like
myself in before the wind blows away.
Do you think that, so there's a physical isolation and there's also psychological isolation. Do you think that reflects anything about the experience of being a feminist writer also? Because not all these books that we're talking about are, like the Sicarians aren't necessarily women. Like the books in the examples, Mission Child, Ammonite, Ancillary Justice, and Left Hand of Darkness, those are all different sexes and genders. So,
did a golden the human narrator and a couple of aliens by gender and one kid who's still after and decided.
Right, so we're branding these as feminist novels, but it isn't necessarily a female pairing. So I guess in some way that's reflected back on authors who set out to write for in the Virgin wrote feminist novels.
It also has the effect, though, of. So what. One of the things about survivalist stories, though, is that they come down to what the people themselves can do in extremity, not the culture they come from or, you know, the institutions that back them up. So I think you can make a very good case that isolating circumstances like that can be intrinsically feminist if they give the female characters a chance to operate without needing to be seen as a part of society or confined by their roles. Like, it does not matter if you come from, you know, a highly, you know, if you come from a highly gendered society, that is totally irrelevant if you've got two people and they both need to be able to make tents and, you know, not lose track of blankets and ration food and walk at the same pace every day. So in like the very basic sense of what women can do, a survivalist story is a great showcase for that sort of thing. And it doesn't need to be all about, you know, how, you know, the guy learned that, oh, geez, women walk really fast. I should learn to beat the cat. You know, if that's something that the reader can do for themselves. And you were talking about cigars.
Yeah. And it's a question of stamina rather than strength.
I think it really strips everything down in a way. Like it's very much a crucible for character, and you know, in an inhospitable frozen tundra environment, it really, I think, in a way, it simplifies things. Like they are forced to make decisions to survive and to rely on each other in a way that they could not do in a tropical environment, because you could kind of go off on your own more. So I think that's why I like it. Even though it has a sense of the epic to it, it makes it a very intimate experience, and I think I like that, that contrast.
I think it's really interesting, Sonya, that you mentioned in the framework of sort of removing the characters from culture, because I was actually thinking about it in terms of several of the examples, in particular Left Hand of Darkness and Ammonite, have one or more characters who is a local, a native, and then one character, the point of view character, who is the outsider. And so the process of surviving and going through this experience is also a sort of transformative acculturation. So they're getting used to the climate, and they're also getting used to that world and the culture that they have there.
Shedding expectations along with unnecessary physical baggage. Yeah, we can't schlep everything 3,000 miles up the over us, so you might as well leave your preciousness at the shore.
Lighten the sledge a little bit.
Yeah.
Right, and in the case of Left Hand of Darkness, it's prejudices that have sort of been built up quite a bit leading up to that. And this is the first time that they're able to, that they're stuck together and forced to acknowledge themselves as they are, rather than as who they present to be. Which I think you had mentioned in email, as sort of the difference between who you have to be in society and who you can be when you don't have those things.
out of that environment sort of strips away the pretenses that you have to dominate when you're in a sort of cultured society setting. There's something about that landscape that allows that sort of removal of all those barriers.
Yeah.
Is there any, I'm sorry.
Well, I was gonna say something, speaking of like the epic quality of the Tundra track, something that I thought of was the epic of Kivia, which is the Inuit, sort of an Inuit story, kind of like the Odyssey of the North, and their stories about Kivia, or Kivia, the character of Siberia as well. And he's a figure who sort of journeys across the Tundra, often by water, and encounters a number of figures. And so many of the figures that Kivia encounters in that landscape are women. He encounters a bee woman, he ends up meeting a wolf woman, he marries a series of goose women as well. So there's something interesting, I think, about the fact that he is on this Tundra trek and he is forming relationships with people on that trek. It's all these women who are already sort of established in the Tundra and he's sort of encountering them. And I think that sort of reinforces that feeling of the Tundra having something innately bent up and being feminine quality to it.
So that makes me think that I should be able to shoehorn the snow queen into this discussion, but I can't.
It's always room for the snow.
That's the thing that keeps recurring. Like if there's something innately feminist about the Tundra, like why are we not having this conversation about, you know, other landscapes? And so your stereotypical Earth feminine association is, you know, endlessly nurturing and endlessly fruitful and, you know, harvesting seeds, time, all sorts of, you know, fantastic agricultural associations, and like seriously there's lots of growing anything above the tree line. So that interests me that we're talking about this as a feminine landscape when its chief characteristics are, you know, permafrost, cloud buried, really stunted trees, and major windburn.
Be women who want to kill you.
Nothing good to do with stuff.
There's a really interesting project. Someone named Kira Van Dusen, who's a storyteller in Canada, went up into different Inuit communities and worked with the elders to gather. There's like a website where she's gathered a bunch of the different versions that different elders hold the encampments. So if you Google it, you'll find it.
So I'm still thinking about the two women.
it's pretty interesting.
Great. Well, I guess we can you think of the example you said of the opposite is Mad Max.
Mm-hmm.
And I can think of a whole lot of desert treks that are sort of guys like Ishtar or something. There's definitely the desert trek by Lawrence of Arabia.
Right. The moment of silence for Omar Sharif.
Oh!
I'm sorry. Right before leaving, I checked the internet. Omar Sharif has died. So. Everybody should envision a dark figure riding out of the mirage of the desert forever. Very, very nice stories. Light of the Phoenix. The 1965 version, not the incredibly crappy remake, which I refuse to acknowledge exists. The desert survivalist story, the only woman not as good as a nation.
I wonder if we'll have more feminist desert survival stories in the wake of the most recent Mad Max.
Yeah.
Because I think that something, when it comes to desert survival and I think of women in that scene, I just think of them dressed, like, for the male gaze. So, like, that's not really something that would be in a feminist tale, whereas in the frozen tundra, there's, like, no precedent for that except for Ursula Guin. So, like, you're, like, fully dressed, first of all. And you can kind of, it's kind of like a blank canvas on which you can paint the story of your choosing. Whereas the desert story has so many, there's a long, I don't know, that just seems like a much more well-traveled place where women have a specific role. Until this most recent Mad Max movie, which is
I actually just realized that I wrote a short story which was a desert feminist buddy track.
It's called Driving X, and it's in the, I don't remember, it's in an anthology, I haven't heard a panel yet where somebody hasn't brought up. And I think that maybe we, like, I think that, that means that we are going to see more tackling of that sort of story, of the feminist story set in that environment. I think we can't help but see the ripples of that. We're already seeing them just in our conversations.
Right.
Yeah, you are ahead of the curve. Go you.
I'm a trendsetter.
Well, I think when in email you asked us a question, which was, how does the buddy truck, the feminist icy buddy truck, relate to other uses of tundra, like isolation or horror? Do you want to talk about that?
Sure. I was thinking of John Campbell and all of the stories that he sort of spawned, like Peter Watts's The Things, where a bunch of people are in the Arctic, and they're dudes, and aliens come and attack them, and it's horrible, and everybody goes to hell. So there's no, it's just about the horror of isolation. There's no coming together and bonding and overcoming. It's just being in the Arctic is a terrible, horrible thing. That seems to be sort of the male version of what to do in the Arctic.
But that actually ties together with what you said, Melinda, about how you feel that desert stories have this very, if you're going to write a feminine desert story, you are working against, you know, years and years of the desert being this masculine province. And the point being that in the tundra, you know, or in cold climates, there's less patriarchy to chip away before you can get to a place where you can actually tell a story. So, and then you bring up the, like, the archetype for, you know, guys in the Arctic is, you know, like, who goes there, and other stories where you're not really getting along anyway, and then the shape changing right. Alien just fucks shit up around you.
I enjoy that story too, but it's very different.
Something I thought of in the terms of isolation horror, even though it's not genre, is the novel Burial Rites. It's historical. It's amazing. It's really interesting. It's a historical fiction novel set in Iceland based on imaginings of true events about a woman who has been convicted of murdering her employer, who in the time between her conviction and her execution is sent to stay on this remote farmstead. And the family who runs the farmstead is horrified that they have been handed this convicted murderess to take care of on the farmstead and to hold, essentially, until she is going to be executed. And it's the story, it sort of it unfolds her story of how this came to happen to her, at the same time that it unfolds her building relationships with the mother and the daughters who were on this farm. And the isolation of that landscape plays a huge role in the story, both in the context of why she came to commit this act, and in the context of why women are forced to actually contemplate their story and to ponder whether it's a thing that could have easily happened to them. And they start out in this place where they despise her and eventually come to have an understanding for what she's been through. And it's all because of the fact that they're in this isolated landscape together, and that forces them to have a reckoning.
So it's not a physical threat, it's an emotional
threat. Exactly, yeah.
And I guess, With the isolation horror, what you're doing is those are always the stories where you chip away people one by one by one by one. You know, they have in space too, and they get the alien thing too, where you know, just slowly you feel everyone off. And these are the stories that we're talking about is instead of that peeling off, it's the coming together when people start more isolated and there's learning to work together either through circumstance or through common understanding, but they're being forced into it by the environment.
No one is coming to save you. Right.
Right. But also no one is necessarily coming to get you.
Okay.
Right. I don't think any of these things that we're talking about have an external bad guy at that moment, I mean, in that segment of the story.
Yeah, it deals with the environment.
Right, the environment is
the... And so it struck me also that none of these are exploration narratives, because the real life template for the ice and the cold eating you alive is things, you know, like Scott of the Antarctic, or, you know, Franklin totally failing on the Northwest Passage, which are real life stories where, you know, the farther you get, the more people drop off, the more terrible the situation becomes. You know, the food isn't good, you just ate the dogs. Do you leave brave, despairing messages for, you know, the empire to find years later when, you know, they excavate you and go, oh shit. and none of these are that kind of story. So I also feel like I don't want to make a huge case for not being like imperialism narrative, but I also feel like that might make a difference. You know, but even you know, like the powder pox came from another world trend is very much about, here we are in the middle of the ice doing science.
Yeah, true.
You know, and I'm really good with people in the middle of the ice doing science. But I'm also interested by the fact that all the stories you're talking about are travel stories in one way or another, which is a different thing from, I totally claim this land in the name of Ian's other guy who didn't freeze yet.
But it's also the exploration, but it diverges from those, because all right, here comes the spoilers, so close your ears if you don't. But they make it to the South Pole and then they erase their tracks, so no one ever knows that these women went to the South Pole. But they know, which is very different than those exploration things where you're claiming, like it's the anti-exploration, like I plant my flag. It's enough to know that you were there.
So these stories are characterized by cooperation and not imperialism.
Yeah.
And I would argue actually counter-imperialism.
Yeah.
Instead of going somewhere and saying, this already inhabited landscape is now mine, they are going somewhere and becoming more familiar with the culture and
letting
the landscape colonize them.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, maybe not colonize.
Fair.
Leave its mark on them. So
that, yeah.
And an idea to throw out. We're talking about the tundra as a feminine environment because we keep meeting these female mythic figures in it. And I'm just automatically thinking about the Odyssey, which is another landscape where you have a dude traveling across this weird landscape and he's meeting these weird mythic female figures, but it's totally not the tundra. So yeah, I... that wasn't a terribly coherent objection, but I'm...
Well, I think the scene, I mean, when you look at the problem...
Right, but I guess what I'm wondering is,
also...
is any foreign landscape, from a male perspective at least, potentially a female environment that you travel across?
Yeah.
The other thing is, I feel like we're ignoring another elephant in the room, which is the great heterosexual buddy trek across the frozen tundra, which is everything by Gene Owl.
Ah!
Oh. I didn't say it was good, I just, you know...
That's true. So can you come out of the case there?
Yeah, yes. Yes. The second through umpteenth.
Yes.
I tapped out after the Plains of Passage. Are in fact a gigantic, extremely heterocentric buddy trek across Ice Age Northern Europe. There are like there's one genderqueer character that I remember in that narrative.
Really?
Hmm?
Wow.
Yeah.
Like, they are completely awesome, and they turn up for like two scenes in the second book, and, I'm like,
and then die.
Yeah. So yeah, that's legit. That exists. That is. I'm not even sure how to classify that, because you're right that you could, in fact, talk about it as being a feminist epic, since it is basically about how this one Cro-Magnon woman invented fucking everything.
We're also not talking about tauntauns.
Yeah.
trying to figure out what it is that makes dropping, you know, a group of women or a mixed group in a tundra environment different from frozen buddy tracks, you know, written by men for male audiences with male protagonists.
I think Nicola Griffith in particular is definitely not arguing that if you have an all-female society, you're going to have a utopia. They reinvent violence and war and, you know, all of the bloody conflicts that you would expect anywhere where resources are short.
And I don't think any of the others are female fairies. Any of them that we dealt with. Of the ones in the examples.
There are two things I wanted to mention. First off, it's interesting that you're talking about the sort of mythological landscape of the tundra being coded female, because the first thing that comes to mind to me is a lot of very male-coded monsters like the Wendigo. Where you have, or the Tlingit giant who the tribe had to kill and then his ashes turned into mosquitoes. And that's where we get them. The giant was a vampire. And so there are also these male monsters. It's not just women as part of the tundra. There are these, so I wanted to point that out. And the other thing I wanted to mention is that the first Inuit-made video game came out earlier this year. And it is a little girl on a tundra track with her dog. It's called Never Alone.
Never Alone?
Yeah.
And it's so cute. So cute.
Again, I put things of cooperation.
Better not eat the dog.
Well, and actually continuing on that tangent for a second, Never Alone is interesting in that it's optional two-player co-op. You can go it alone, or you can have someone play the dog and help you along.
Oh, God.
I was wondering if part of the appeal of the tundra to a feminist writer is also not that it's a feminine landscape, but that it is a hostile, inimical landscape, and that part of the experience of being female in society involves making your way through a landscape that's not made for you. So whether it's female characters cooperating in the tundra or not, that maybe part of the reason to cooperate is deep-rooted in our experience of living in the world, and that the landscape becomes a metaphor for society that way.
And, you know, since they are, most of the buddy tracks and books you're talking about are of mixed gender, it kind of shows that that landscape is hostile for the male characters who have to make their way through it as well.
Yeah, it's not about being feminine, it's about being feminist.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really important distinction.
I just want to throw out one more example. Marion Zimmer Bradley has a ton of treks, and some of them are gutter treks, some of them are mountain treks, some of them are in very cold landscapes, and that happens to be the one that is her most feminist and most spiritual book. And I don't know quite what to make of that, because I haven't read the book in a while, but just if you were going to look at these things again.
Does anybody on the panel or in the audience have information about what the authors thought about the particular landscape they dropped their characters into? Do we have any idea, actually, of why they made this decision?
I know that Maureen McHugh from Mission Child had three very distinct, it's basically three stories. One was ice, one was city, what's the third one? And what was that, island or something like that? But I know that very distinctly it was this is the landscape I'm walking this character into to see what happens. And they're very, and each of those is a very different journey with different people encountered and the characters experiencing themselves in different ways in each of those settings. Anyone else?
Anyone
have the information on that one?
Yes, we can ask. Anyone
else? I remember reading an interview with Ursula K where she said the image of two characters crossing the glacier was the seminal image of the Montana darkness. And then when she first saw that vision, she didn't have any sense of the gender of the characters. And I think it's also interesting, the Left Handed Darkness, that the ice of the planet is not really essential to the gender issues. That planet could look like anything and still have androgynous people, or partly androgynous people. And I was also thinking while you were talking about that, that I guess technically in a way there aren't any female characters in left-handed darkness. And the place where Estreia becomes female is on the ice, right in the middle of their journey, which makes things really complicated. Which I don't know what to make of that. Maybe somebody else has an idea.
Well, somebody much earlier on the panel, I cannot remember, said that the landscape strips you down to yourself, who you are, without any societal pretense or, you know, without a mask of culture for the other person to look at and just perceive you as, you know, a particular piece of here's the way the world works. So I think Estreia is always female as much as they're male or as much as they're neither. And that's the thing that Gwendolyn has never quite gotten or been able to understand. Gwendolyn is always using male pronouns with the Essenians all the time. She's always kind of thinking of everyone around him as sort of default male with maybe, you know, every now and then the king's pregnant. And on the ice with Estreia physically female in camera for the first time, that's seeing Estreia clearly in a way that he hasn't been able to or hasn't been able to let himself be before. This is also who Estreia is. This is who Theram is. It's where they start using first names for the first time. It's where they learn mind speech, which you can't lie in. And so that manifestation has always very clearly been for me not anything about Estreia being the symbolic of the environment, but just being symbolic of who they are themselves in their entirety, not just the one particular face that Gwendolyn is most comfortable seeing.
And it's a moment where Gwendolyn is forced to acknowledge the other aspects, where previously he could ignore or continue thinking about Estreia as male. This is a moment where everything is like bare, and it's intimate. Like being on the ice with someone else, it is an intimate moment because they are forced to cooperate. They're forced into closeness.
And if you're fighting for your survival, what you bring with you is all you have. You know, you have to be seen for all your best and your worst qualities because you don't have time for pretense. You don't have time for defense. You don't have anything that can camouflage that. You know, if actually you are the sort of person who burns out after 2 hours of walking, that's not a moral judgment. That's how you are. And the other person who's traveling with you is going to have to recognize that, and you're going to have to reckon with it yourself. You're going to have to adjust, you know, your journey to account for that. And so that's just part of the honesty.
And I think on the ice, there's very little that you're going to encounter. I think we talked about this earlier a little. If you're talking about a jungle or a desert, there are certain things you expect to encounter. And we talked about running into all these, you know, women along the way in some of these stories, but in a desert story, there's always an oasis. In, you know, if you're in a jungle, there's all kinds of light teeming about. But in these stories,
it's basically you.
Yeah.
Right. If you're not afraid that there's some Mayan.
Right. Right. Yeah.
So we haven't talked very much about ancillary justice and how it plays in. And I wonder if the rest of you guys have some thoughts about. So it seems to me that the protagonist, who I'm blanking on the name of right now, but
Breck,
starts out from a point of view of just not really getting the whole gender thing. You know, like, I can't be arsed to tell the difference between males and females, you know? All of the social cues are different depending on which planet I'm on and which culture I'm in, so I'm just not even going to bother thinking about it. Which is a really different starting place from all of the other examples that we can come up with, which generally start from our perspective of heteronormative gender views.
I know that for me, I mean, the reason, like, literally I came out of our panel last year and I wrote the proposal for this because we were talking about it, but that moment in Ancillary Justice, when the two of them are there, and I think it was on the bridge, and I just felt this connection with all these other, with these specific other books that had come before, and it was a real connection for me, but I wasn't even thinking about it as the connection between the characters as much as between me and the book at that moment. Anyone else on Ancillary Justice?
Well, I actually haven't read any books that were sort of this, so I read them all in like a big rush in a couple of weeks leading up to the convention, so they're all kind of twined together in my mind. But I feel like it's impossible to not imagine that Ancillary Justice and Ammonite are in conversation with Left Hand of Darkness, especially that sort of decision to, in Left Hand of Darkness, the decision is to use the masculine assumption, essentially. Which shifts, throughout the book, but where then you have Ammonite and Ancillary Justice that uses the feminine assumption instead, and then makes that sort of different choice in order to have a conversation with it. So,
Ancillary Justice makes the argument to some degree that it doesn't matter which, the gender doesn't matter in that moment, which I think that a lot of these books are saying that it's about people at that moment that you're on the ice, and whoever those two people are, the connection and the cooperation that we're talking about. So we only have a couple minutes left, so what I'd actually like to do, thank you all for being a wonderful panel, and a wonderful audience.
Science, which is my newest collection, and I'll have copies of it, and people should totally come and listen to it.